المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين الذي خلقنا مسلمين، والحمد لله رب العالمين الذي خلقنا أصحاء معافين. الله كريم، الله عز كريم. والحمد لله رب العالمين الذي جعلنا بعقل وإدراك ودراية لنعلم كيف نعبد الله عبادة يرضاه ونحظى بمغفرته وبرحمته إن شاء الله. Say Ameen. All praises and thanks be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He created us Muslims. And all praises and thanks be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He created us healthy and able to function as a human being. And also all thanks and praises be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He created us with mental state or capacity so we can worship Allah and understand Allah the way He wants us to do, in order for us to get from Him His mercy and His forgiveness, inshallah. I want to remind myself and all of us here, and please remind your own closest members of the family that Allah loves you so much. Allah loves you so much that you cannot find any which way to say thank you. Why? Because there is no measures to the love of Allah that will be equal to the word thank you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created the whole universe for you. He created everything for you and me and him and her and everybody, young or old. Allah created the whole universe for us to enjoy and to take benefit from. And He done a lot of things that honestly Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, thank you, mashallah. That's it, this is it. My God, He is one of the best kids around here. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. You know why I come here? Not to see your face or his, just to get this. MashaAllah. Bismillah. Why, you don't have enough sugar? Don't be like Afghanis, they don't drink tea or anything with sugar. May Allah bless them. Say Ameen. Those people are beautiful people. Oh, it's a brown, you have a multicolor sugar. Barakallah, yes, I like that. We Arab like only the white sugar. So alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah, for the brothers who are always taking care of me, that's one of the reasons I come to see you. And the French benefits here, they always, mashallah. Anyhow, let's go back to the main subject, that Allah loves us so much. And I asked you last week to ask yourself, is there anybody who wrote anything about my question? My assistant over there, you should have wrote me the notes when I asked you last week as a homework. Write down, how do you know that Allah loves you? You remember that question? I'm going to quit this place. Nobody's doing whatever I ask for. No, nobody. Okay, that's the first warning. Two strikes, three strikes, and I'm out. If you prove that you don't want to listen to me anymore, you don't want to do whatever I'm asking you, I'm leaving. That's a threat. Watch it. So, alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. I'm saying that Allah loves us so much. I gave you the hint, the first hint. Look at yourself in the mirror and see why Allah loves you. If you looked at the mirror, then you know why Allah loves you. I hope you know. But if you cannot look at yourself because your mirror is broken, your mirror at home is broken, borrow my car's mirror, you know, the side, you can go and take a look at yourself in there and say, take a look and see how much Allah loves you when you look at yourself in the mirror. So So one of those reasons, do you think Allah will create better face than mine? No way. You ask yourself the same question, and you too. Do you think Allah will create better face than that one? You ask yourself. Or you do. Nobody, okay.
How about you, alaykum salam? How about you? You think Allah will create better face than yours?
Alright. So, what I'm saying is, Allah created the best face for you. This is the first thing you should ask yourself, saying, Ya Allah, thank you for this beautiful face, that no other face like it. Even if there is a twin brother of yours, he has the same face as yours, but still he has differences in the makeup and genetic manipulation of the face. The face itself is going to be manipulated differently, even if they look the same. But there's inside, the activities inside the face is totally different than the twin brother. So these are the signs that how much Allah loves you. One of them, the beginning. The second one, and so on, you write down what are the things that mandates for you to think why Allah loves you. And if you find out one reason or two or three or hundred or thousand or million or trillion reasons, it's not enough yet. Because each one of those ways of loving you, it's ni'mah. It's called what? Ni'mah. And Allah said in two surah of Quran, surah called Ibrahim, and the other one surah al-Nahl, which is the bees. If you read the Quran, you know what Allah says? وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. If you want to count the blessings, the ni'mah of Allah, you will never be able to count how many. Even if all the human, all the jinn, all the malaika got together, helping each other to find and count how many ni'mah we have, we'll not be able to count it. One of those ones, I'm saying, just take a good look at everything and then focus in one. Who is teaching you this deen? Who taught you from the beginning until now? Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That person, that creature, that the best creation of Allah among humans, that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Do we know our teacher? Do we know his name? Do we know his description? If I ask you, describe your teacher to me. Can you describe Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to me? Can you? Can anybody? How do you follow somebody you don't know? Even have to tell me about it. How do you follow somebody blindly without even know how he looks like? For us, we look at some of the idols, we see Zenus, we see Hercules, we see Cleopatra, we see those people, we don't know how they look like. And they are kafir, and those people are filthy. How about your Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Have you ever took the time to read something about how he looks like? We go to the movies, we're still thinking about the stars of the movies, we think of how this girl looks like, and that man, and this, and so on. But your Prophet, you don't know how he looks like? Amazing. The Sahaba companions, when they were spreading after the death of Rasulullah, when they spread all the corners of the earth to teach Islam, or to spread Islam, they've been asked the first question, who's your Prophet? This is Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Describe him to us. Each one of them, he described the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam exactly. And you could see it in their faces when they describe the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the excitement, the light coming from their faces when they are telling about him. Imagine him, if you can tell how he looks like. In the meantime, do you have any idea what hardship he went through to bring you Islam? Do you know how much struggle he went through to bring you the Islam that you are sitting here to talk about and waiting to be entertained by this, you know,
this man here behind this counter to entertain you. You here come to just to listen, enjoy it. If you don't enjoy me, you walk out. This guy is boring. You leave. Imagine if we're talking about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Majority of the nations that accepted Islam for three reasons. One of them, the character of the Sahaba, when they see them, their dignity, their attitude, their honesty, their truthfulness, that nation accepted Islam because this is one reason. Second reason, when they've been talking about Allah and Quran, they see the excitement and the truthful and honesty talking about Allah. Third reason, when they talk about the teacher who taught them this deen, they talk about it, they could see a reflection in their faces. How much you love this Muhammad of yours. That's all the three reasons nations, your nation, my nation, everybody else has accepted Islam until now because of the Sahaba, the companion, their love of Rasul and love of Allah and love of their deen. Now, this man, the one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dedicated to teach us this deen, if I ask you, what's his name?
Everybody knows his name is Muhammad, okay.
Okay. Do you know any other names after that? Some of us will know. 1, 2, 3 names. But do you know the whole lineage of them? No. But I ask you about your grandfather or your wife or your husband or your friend. You know up to the 17th grandfather, you know this, the lineage. But Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what do we know about him? We went through this again and again and again and again, but still, anybody wrote down to memorize it, to remember it? No. And I talked about this for so many times, and we went through the first, when we started the Seerah of a Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we first thing discussed what? His name. And we repeated that how many times, Madhat? How many times? He's cheating me. We have more than that. We have more than that. And every once in a while, we used to remind you with it. I'm asking at least know the first four names of his. Because we know it's Bani Hashim. Bani Hashim is his clan. The branch of Quraysh is called Bani Hashim. At least I want everyone to know his name up to Hashim. Hashim is the father. Bani is the children of Hashim. So, let me see what kind of candy I can give the person who will tell me his name. Start from the right. Huh? His name. No, from Muhammad's name. Muhammad, his father, his grandfather, and her fourth name.
I think it's Abdul.
Tell me the name as if I'm asking you, what's your name? You say, my name is so and so and so and so, and this is it. Yes or no?
I know, like, Abdullah is.
I'm saying, do you know the four names right away?
No.
Okay. Do you?
I can.
Yes or no? That can or can't? I want you to say. You?
Hamad Abdullah Abdul Muttalib.
This guy is a good one, mashallah. I like that. So everybody now we don't know. You know now. I like that. What's the name again? Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn Abd al-Muttalib ibn Hashim. Remember those ones will be enough for now. But if I encourage you, you have to know more. But for now, at least if anybody asks you, give me his name. You say he's Muhammad Abdullah ibn Abd al-Muttalib ibn Hashim. That's the name. If you have his, you know, driver license of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it says Muhammad Abdullah Abdul Muttalib Pasha. You understand that? You think he was qualified to be a driver, to have a license? If he can drive the Ummah, you think he can drive a utility? He drove camels, he drove donkeys and mules, and he drove horses and so on, drove men also.
we drove men. But the idea is, I want you to start knowing him. I'd love for you to dig deep down to see how much of knowledge you can have about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We are discussing his seerah. We went through the beginning, before his birth, until he was born, how what happened after that, his childhood, his also teenage years, his manhood, and then when until he got to 40 years, after that he was a prophet, Nabi, how he got the nubuwah, how he got the prophethood, and how he started doing it in Mecca. The first period was in Mecca, the second period was in Medina. The second period, what happened? What happens during that one? My phone or yours? Let me check. Well, looks like my phone is complicated. Okay. I'm learning, still learning to drive this telephone. But anyway, the whole idea is, we discussed up to this point so many phases of his life. From the beginning, now we are in Medina after the second battle, which called Battle of Uhud, the one the Muslims, they've been defeated. We have discussed some of the names of people who got killed from the Sahaba of companions. As some of you remember, in top of the list, the uncle of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, his name is?
Hamza.
Who said first one, who said Hamza?
He's the boy.
Same you did? Okay. You deserve one. I don't care. There you go. So I want you to be awake so we can have lots of candy. Allah gave us a lot today, mashallah. So the idea is, we discussed the phase that the uncle of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the most beloved to his heart, his uncle, Hamza. They grew together. Hamza and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam grew together. Their manhood and their youth and all of that one was almost in the same road. And then he sees him killed. How much sorrow he had in his heart. And the way they destroyed the body of Hamza by that woman, the daughter of Abu Sufyan, the wife of Abu Sufyan, she came and cut his belly, took his liver, and started chewing it as a revenge, because Hamza in the Battle of Badr killed her brother and her father and her one of her sons. So she wanted to take revenge. So she did that. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he saw that, his inside was in the sorrow, in the sadness, so bad. So we're going to skip that now. Now we pass that one. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is taking care of a new state, new country, new nation in Medina. So he's thinking now, what to do to protect this Medina and the people in it, and Islam, and his own safety. Remember, in Mecca, only two kinds of people there, either believer or disbeliever. You know, whoever standing this way or that way, they are known. In Medina, they are more complicated. In Medina, he knows the believers, but he doesn't know the munafiqeen. Munafiqeen, he knows also there are Jews there. And there were Christians there too. And there was atheists from other countries when they used to come for trade. So it's more complex now. New country, new nation, more complex. It needs to be protected and regulated and protect Islam in it. And also all around Medina, all the areas around Medina, they are threat to Medina because they are allies to Quraysh. They are friends to Quraysh. So what happened? The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam first order of business after the Battle of Uhud, he buried the dead. Buried the martyr, the shuhada. Some of the people, the families of some of those ones, they came and took their bodies to bury them in Medina. But the rule of Islam, a shaheed or martyr to be killed in the battle, he has to be buried in the same spot he died. You understand that, brothers? In the future heaven, this one, any shaheed or any martyr to be killed in the sake of Allah, to be buried in the same spot, in the area of the way he died, the place where he died. And shaheed cannot be washed. Has to be buried in his own clothes, in his own, whatever he has on. And not to be cleaned except the face. You understand that, brothers? And to be buried in the same spot. So here it is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you get defeated because of something happened. Some of the Muslims did not obey. They are thinking of dunya, but Allah forgave them. Look at the beautiful Allah said, they are the cause of the defeat, the cause of those of many people died. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, just because khalatu amalun salih, amalun sayyid, that means they got mixed up. So I forgive them. So start fresh. So Rasulullah took that energy. Now we start thinking, now we're going to protect ourselves. He started preparing another campaign to go around to protect Medina from all around, to defend Medina. And then he starts sending campaigns of platoons of soldiers to go attack certain areas which they killed Muslims individual. Threat, some small tribes, they used to come to Rasulullah, send with us somebody to teach us how to pray. As soon as those people gone there, they killed them. So Rasulullah said, now we have to teach people a lesson, not to trick us into certain things. In one time, 70 of the Muslims being slaughtered. There is another area, 10, another area, 2 or 3. They're being killed everywhere. So Rasulullah now he said, now we have to establish that we have reputation to protect, to show the kafirin that we are here to stay. So he started to organize certain campaigns to go different directions. And these are called ghazawat. What is called in Arabic? Ghazawat, which means campaigns or a group of soldiers, they go to mission, for a special mission. In the meantime, the greatest threat is Quraysh and Makkah. What happened? In the meantime, they are doing another thing to be watched for the Jews, because the Jews are treacherous. They have some agreement with the Rasulullah ﷺ, don't help my enemy against Medina. But they used to be underground in secret, they go to manipulate other tribes to come in different areas, to come to kill Muslims and to manipulate. So there is a family of Jews or a tribe of Jews called Bani Nadir. What are they called? Bani Nadir. They used to have four. How many? How many Jewish tribes? Four in Medina and Mecca. Bani Qurayza, Bani Nadir, Bani Qaynuqa. What is the fourth one? You remember? I didn't have my breakfast, that's why my mind is not. Bani Mustalim, Barakallah, he is one of them. Two of them, one for me, one for Mustalim. Barakallah, Jazakallah khair. So the idea, the Rasulullah ﷺ, he had a problem before with them. And he gave an agreement with them, and he says, if you do, I will kick you out from the city. I will not allow you to live with us. We have enough to give, don't worry, but keep this for you. You sneak later on, not I'm in front of everybody. So here's the idea. Rasulullah ﷺ starts gathering the Muslim and says, okay, here's what we're going to do. We're going to protect Medina. We're going to protect Islam. We're going to protect campaigns. Whoever we send ambassadors to go and teach another tribe, be careful, be watchful. Now, Bani Nadir, this tribe of Jews in Medina, the day the Prophet ﷺ came to Medina, he had an agreement with them. He wrote down an agreement, a pact. They call it pact. We live with each other, so we protect each other. If anybody attacks you, we're going to defend you. If anybody attacks us, you're going to defend us. But they did not do that. When Rasulullah ﷺ was fighting in battle of Uhud, They backed off. They don't want to be with them. Especially there is a guy named Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Abi Salul. This is the best among all kafir. He is the worst munafiq. He pretends he is a Muslim, but he's not. Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Abi Salul. And this guy, he went back from this tribe and he started telling them, okay, break the pact with the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and start doing different things. How about if we can kill him? So the plan is to kill the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he told all the branches of his tribe, let's bring solid guys, you know, very strong guys, and everybody has a dagger or a knife. And we ask Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to come to our neighborhood to teach us Islam. We'll listen to him. We'll tell him, we're going to listen to you. If we accept Islam, we'll be Muslim. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you know, he's willing to do anything for people to accept Islam, especially the Jews. He was concentrating because they are the people of the book. They know Allah better than the rest. If they accepted Islam, we'll be very powerful, solid Muslim, you know. Anyhow, so he came to their neighborhood. So all of those people were around him. You know, he said, they told him, okay, sit here. They sat here, and people start, you know, around him. Then they changed the plan, not to attack him with the dagger. They start saying, who can take this rock, a huge stone rock this size, go up to the roof, and while he's sitting, he doesn't know, throw it at his head so it'll crush him, and he dies. Actually, there were people who said, okay, we'll do it. So they got up the roof and they hooked the rock and they want to throw it. Then they left the rock and ran away. Why? Jibreel alayhi salam came in, showed them some of his faces that he can make. So they found like a monster is going to eat them. So they threw the rock and they ran away. And then Jibreel told the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam turned around, went to Medina and issued an order for them. You have to leave Medina in 10 days. If you don't leave it, after 10 days, whoever we find, we're going to kill. So what they've done? They asked him, okay, what can we take with us? He said, take anything you want, money, furniture, food, anything, but you cannot take your weapons. You leave your weapons here. Here comes Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul. He went to Khaybar and he told people of Khaybar, the Khaybar is a fortress for the Jews. And he told them, they are going to be, you know, kicked out, so let's help them out. So they start to make a noise. And then the people of Khaybar told them, if the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam attacked you, we'll come to help. The same thing like a shaitan said, To a man, he says, Ukfar, when he made kufr, he says, I'm innocent from what you, I did not force you. And he said, he represented himself to the ideas of the Jews, so they came and he went again to the tribes there around. There are another tribe that's called Ghatafan, another tribe, a huge tribe in Arabia. They said, okay, let's go with the Jews, kill Muhammad in Medina, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam issued an order and he showed that I am serious. So those people ran away to Khaybar and refused to surrender. So he had a siege against Khaybar. And they used to throw arrows and spears on the Muslims. They used to have their gardens full of date trees, you know, the huge trees, so they have a cover. They are, you know, against Islam. So the Muslims were short-handed, always receiving, but they cannot do something. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, okay, let's hurt them, let's hit them where it hurts the most. Cut all the date trees and burn it. Imagine. The first time Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ordered to destroy something that Allah put here. But it was a plan by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? To expose them and to hurt them. These are our fortune. They used to have a trade from this days. So all of it. So they came down to fight. But now they are facing the Muslim. And the Muslim are known the fear they can reflect to anybody. When they see the Muslim coming to fight, how could you defeat somebody who wants to die? Is there anybody who could defeat a person who wants to die? Which means they want shahada, they don't know, they want to go to Jannah right away. They want to get killed. But before they get killed, what? They're going to fight until they get killed. And the Jews are cowards. In general, Allah said so in the Quran, not me only. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, they will never fight you face to face. They have to fight you behind walls, behind this, so they can be, you know, protecting themselves against you. So they are full of fear. So after 10 days, again, they surrendered. They came down and surrendered. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, okay, you can go home, pick up whatever you want, take anything you want, but leave your weapons. You remember the terminology in the wars, especially in Europe war against Russia, the German against Russia, they called it siyasat al-ard al-mahruqa, which means burned land. When they are escaping the land, they used to burn their own homes. They used to burn all their own factories and this. But they could not burn something that's already, you know, mud. You cannot burn mud, the mud houses. You know what they've done? They went to their windows and doors, they pulled them out from the walls. Imagine, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in surah called Surah Al-Hashr, يُخْرِبُونَ أَمَا أَبْيُوتَهُمْ بِأَيْدِيهِمْ. They are destroying their own homes. You know why? Because they don't want the Muslim to benefit from it. So they destroyed everything they used to live in, so the Muslim cannot use it. Rasulullah said, good riddance, we don't need it. It's cursed even because of the Jews, they are cursed. So Rasulullah took all their weapons, everything they used to own, and the rest, and they gone to Syria. They left to go to where? Sham. Sham, which is now Syria called, or Jordan, Lebanon, Palestine, and Syria, the complex. It used to be called Sham. So that phase is done. So Rasulullah ﷺ cleaned them up. Who stayed in the picture? The other two tribes left. There was one before Bani Qurayza and Bani Nadir. Now there are two more tribes, Bani Mustalak and Bani Qaynuqa. So now, going back to the first battle. The first battle was called Badr, remember? The first battle that the Muslims fought people of Mecca. And also they are having a promise with the Rasulullah ﷺ. After the Battle of Uhud, they asked the Rasulullah ﷺ to meet them on the anniversary to revenge Badr. To revenge Badr, it's called the second Badr. It's okay. So the second Badr, so Rasulullah ﷺ, he took 1,500 soldiers from the Sahaba companion, and went to Badr again, to the same location, and waited for 15 days. Abu Sufyan and the people of Makkah, they said, okay, the time of Badr, let's go. So Abu Sufyan gathered 2,000 soldiers of his, warriors, very solid warriors, and they came close. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala installed in their heart the fear of the Muslims. So Abu Sufyan, when he started thinking, he says, we are 2,000, he might have 2,000, so we cannot defeat 2,000 Muslims. Because they used to say one Muslim equals 10 of them. You remember first Badr? They have 300, and those people they had 1,000. So they said, with the three against one, they defeated us. In Uhud, we have 10,000 and they have 1,000, so for one, each one is 10. So now they have 2,000. We have 2,000 and they have about 1,000 or 1,500. We're not matched. So he said, you know what? I'm going home. Anybody wants to go home, let's go home. So Badr, the second Badr, the second occasion of Badr, was canceled by the fear of Quraysh. They are afraid. So this second one is canceled. There is another one. Because of this, what happens? Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, the Jewish munafiq, or the Muslim munafiq, he was at the time declaring him a Muslim, but he was not. And he started going to all the tribes, big tribes, plus Quraysh. And he was spending money to recruit missionaries to go to gather together. And they said, okay, we gather 10,000 soldiers. Let's attack Medina and destroy it once and for all. Now when the news came to Rasulullah, he asked the people, the Sahaba, okay, what are we going to do? There was 10,000 soldiers coming to attack us, to kill us. So what are we going to do? Go out, face them, or stay in Medina and defend ourselves? So everybody gave their ideas. This man, he said, Ya Rasulullah, would you like a suggestion? He says, yes. He said, we used to do in Persia. Anybody remembers who is that we're talking about?
Yeah.
Who said that? You did? You did? Oh, mashallah. There's the guy who cost me a lot of time. Mashallah. His name is Salman al-Farisi radiallahu anhu. He's from Ahlul Bayt now. Okay? Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said Salman is from Ahlul Bayt. He's one of us. So every time you mention him, say radiallahu anhu, and he's from the Ahlul Bayt. He said, Ya Rasulullah, we in Persia, we used to be, if we are attacked by large force, we used to dig a ditch around this village or the city we are in, so they cannot cross over. And no, nothing happened to us except by the arrows, you know. He said, it's a good idea, let's do it. Medina, anybody went to Medina?
Yes.
Okay. Do you have any idea how it looks like? No, I know, okay. But I'll explain it to you. Medina is built in the palm of three large mountains. Three large mountains. And the Medina is right here. There is only the north side, which is towards Syria, not towards Mecca, is the open land. And that open land, that's where they dug the ditch with Salman al-Farisi. So Rasulullah divided them. Every 10 of Sahaba, you're responsible for digging 40 feet of ditch. And I'm with you, and he started to be with them. And there was, at the time, there was famine, like they don't have product to eat. And they are, the heat of the sun was awful. So they used to dig and tire. And some of them, they, because of the hunger, they put rocks and tie them up to their bellies. So they came, Ya Rasulullah, we're hungry. Can anyway you ask Allah to bring us food? He said, look at me. So he had two rocks in here. He said, you have one, I have two. But anyway, there is Jabir ibn Abdullah radiallahu anhu, a young man. He had a, you know, a horse, and he had a sheep. So he slaughtered one of them, and he said, Ya Rasulullah, I have some meat for 10 people. Is that okay with you? 10 people only. Please don't ask anymore. Is that okay? Subhanallah. They said, listen to the miracle of that incident. They said 1,000 people ate, and still they are cooking. They are cooking bread, and they're cooking rice and meat. And the 1,000 they ate to their fill. And still people, still there is more food still. The barakah of that little tiny sheep and that thing. So here what happens, while they are waiting, it's called Ghazwatul Khandak. What is it? Al-Khandak, which is the ditch, like the trench. So 10,000 came in. Whoops, what happened? So he said, the Rasulullah, he said, okay, the flag should be carried by someone who is very, very powerful and strong. Hadrat Ali radiallahu anhu. So he gave him the flag and he says, protect that area. There is a rock. Nobody could break it. A rock. In between the ditch, when they are digging the ditch, like the ditch is 20 feet wide, 10 feet down. That tells you how much hardship they had. 10 feet down, 20 feet wide. So the horses cannot jump. People, they cannot come. 10 feet, you drop here, you cannot climb again if they want to be on their foot. And also, the only thing is arrows and that rock. So he said, Ya Ali, you protect the rock with 10 of your strongest friends. And everybody else around the Mecca and protected the mountain from the behind, you know, just in case if some of them climbed the mountain, like Khalid ibn al-Walid in Ma'arakat Uhud, in the Battle of Uhud, he climbed the mountain and he killed. So he's distributed the men to defend Medina. While they are digging, they said, Ya Rasulullah, this rock, we cannot break it. You know, what happens if they are coming through? They can push themselves, they are 10,000, you know. We cannot, you know, stop them. So he said, okay, give me the axe. This is the most beautiful point to me. He struck the rock with one axe, there is a spark in it. Spark. Now everybody is shaken from fear, by the way. They are Muslim at the time, they are shaking because they could see the army, 10,000 there. How could we defeat those guys? So everybody's afraid. Everybody saying, okay, this is it, you know. Do or die here, please. No buts about it. And everybody is shaking because they said, maybe this is the end of Islam. This is it. So Rasulullah came with the axe and he struck the rock with one, but did not break it, but there is a spark came in. And then Rasulullah was smiling, good news. They said, what, Ya Rasulullah? He said, I saw the palaces of Faris, of Persia, you're going to be ruling it. Imagine you are in a situation of death, and somebody says you're going to be going to the moon. What happens? Logically, nobody could believe that. But because they loved Rasulullah, they said, yes, Ya Rasulullah. But we are now here. How can, you know, this happen? If we survive, yes. But if we don't survive, we are here. Then he says, okay. Second time he struck the rock. And he said again, good news, spark again. They said, what is it, Ya Rasulullah? I said, the palaces of Roman, you're going to be ruling that. Now this is too much for them to handle. So all of them said, yes, but logical is not acceptable, no matter how they force themselves. But he said, you know, I don't say anything from me as a hope or wishful thinking. This is a vision from Allah that we're going to do it. So that lifted their spirit up a little bit. And then the face-off started. The face-off started when they initiated the battle. And Rasulullah, he was participating in it in every aspect by helping the wounded and carrying the weapons and doing this and doing that. And everybody doing the same thing. But there was no action fight, except just on the top of the rock, few of them, and then they backed off. Because Hadrat Ali, they said he himself alone killed 70 of those people who attacked. Imagine the number of people attacked at that time, if you can kill 70. So anyhow, then they went back again, then suddenly, something called sandstorm. You remember anybody who was in Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, or the Gulf? They have something called sandstorm. Tornado, but it's sand. So those people, which is Allah, sent one of his soldiers. Soldier is called tornado. And the tornado full of sand. So they could not sit still for 1 minute. Their tents being upside down, their horses running everywhere. Everything they put it to cook food or anything being turned over and filled with sand. So they could not survive for 1 day, 2 days, 3 days, 4 days, and so on. Then suddenly they said, the heck with it, let's leave. So they left. So the idea is there was no actual battle. It's called Ghazwat al-Khandak or Al-Ahzab. Another name is called Al-Ahzab. Al-Ahzab means the ally, the coalition, like the American do when in Iraq and Afghanistan, they said coalition. This is called Al-Ahzab also in Islamic terms. So this is what happens. They left with no fighting, no war, or nothing except the first initial attack with the Iraq area, and they've been defended, and that was it. So from the suffering they went through, from the wind and the sand and that stuff, it was done by the grace of Allah, nothing happened to the Muslim at the time. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said this in the Surah Al-Ahzab, the same Surah called Al-Ahzab. A'udhu billahi min shaitan rajeem, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. The first ayah, it says, I want to share it with you because we're going to come close to start. He said in Surah Al-Ahzab, ayah number 11, 10 and 11, he said, إِذْ جَاءُوكُمْ مِنْ فَوْقِكُمْ وَمِنْ أَسْفَلِ مِنْكُمْ وَإِذْ زَاغَتِ الْأَبْصَارُ وَبَلَغَتِ الْقُلُوبُ الْحَنَاجِرُ وَيَظُنُّونَ بِاللَّهِ الظُّنُونَ هُنَالِكَ ابْتُلِيَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَزُلْزِلُوا زِلْزَالًا شَدِيدًا. Allah said in this ayah, He said when the news came in, that they came in from north, south, east, and those ones, the enemies, they told the Muslims, they are coming with a huge army from every direction. So, you better get ready to die, the munafiqeen telling them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described the fear in their heart, the Muslim, the fear in the Muslim's heart. إِذْ زَاغَتِ الْقُلُوبُ وَبَلَغَتِ الْأَبْصَارُ وَبَلَغَتِ الْقُلُوبُ الْحَنَاجِرُ. It means their eyes start to run around, my God, we're gonna die. And their heart, you know, you remember somebody when he's facing a lion or monster, how he's going to react? This is the Muslim. Allah described the Muslim at that time. And the people said, hey, you're going to die, definitely. So, and then they said, maybe Allah doesn't want us to win. So they start thinking about Allah's going to, you know, abandon them. That means he's going to allow the kafir to kill them. That's the thought of Shaytan, he said to the Muslim at the mind. Allah described that. And he said, that is the test of the mu'mineen, the believers. And they've been shaken, so much shaken, zilzal and shadida, which means worse than earthquake in their heart, like earthquake. When he's this one, now listen what he said after the battle. This before, the same surah, in ayah number 12, the second, the verse number 12 of Surah Al-Ahzab, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَمَّا رَأَى الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الْأَحْزَابِ. When the believers saw the enemies or the ahzab, قَالُوا, they said, now the faithful, the strong faithful Muslim, mu'min, they said, هَذَا مَا وَعَدَنَا اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. This is what will be promised to be tested. We cannot go to Jannah without being tested, the strong test. Ibtila, it means large and huge and difficult test. وَصَدَقَ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. And they are truthful. They told us the truth. صَدَقَ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. They promised to be tested and they are truth. This is the truth. And he said, وَمَا زَادَهُمْ إِلَّا إِيمَانًا وَتَسْلِيمًا. These strong believers, this increases their faith and their submission to Allah. They said, ya Allah, okay, whatever you do to us, we accept it because we believe in you. So here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the munafiqeen said, the munafiq, you remember what munafiq is? They said, مَا وَعَدَنَا اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ إِلَّا غُرُورًا. You know the wa'id, the promise that they're going to rule Rome and Persia and win the battle here? The munafiqeen, they used to say, Muslimin, Allah is falsely telling you this. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam falsely telling you, fabricated story, just to get your mind of fear. Allah said that in Surah Al-Ahzab in here. So Rasulullah, when it's over and the mushrikeen, the kuffar left, he said to the believers, to the Sahara, he said, okay, let's get ready. Who wants to go and fight now? We're going to continue fight. Because most of them said, Alhamdulillah, they left. Sigh of relief, you know, when your enemy leaves you, sigh of relief. But the Rasulullah said, no, don't slow down. Who wants to go with me? Let's go and fight. They said, ya Rasulullah, but you know, Allah gave us a break. We're not fighting them, you know, at least you know, enjoy what we have. Said, no, we have to establish something. That's good idea. Let's go. And the Rasulullah, he wants to show the whole Arabia, we are not weak. We're going to be fighting to the death. So he called the Muslims, and then before he leaves Mecca, look at Rasulullah's wisdom. The Rasul, whenever he leaves Medina, sorry, did I say Mecca first? No, I said Medina. Every time he leaves Medina, he appoints somebody to rule Medina in his place, like vice president. God forbid me not to say, but he used to leave somebody in charge. And who's going to be in charge after Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? Somebody has to be a good personality, somebody who could order people, who could, his faith is true faith with Allah. You won't believe it. You know who he appointed? Anybody knows the name, I will give you five candies.
Abu Bakr?
Abu Ali?
It was a kid, right?
A kid.
The blind man.
The blind man.
Thank you. Here. A blind man, his name is Abdullah ibn Maktoum.
Yes,
Maktoum. I promised to you. You guys, please, in the future, when you see him coming, close the door. Don't let him. He's costing me so much. Mashallah, mashallah, mashallah. I love this man dearly. So, alhamdulillah, so imagine a leader of the ummah leaves a blind person to be in charge. That tells you Islam has no discrimination. Islam, no discrimination, not even a bit. In one another incident, they appointed a black, a Abyssinian, an Arab. Imagine at the time of Arab, they used to look at blacks even as slaves. And the idea was, you know, they can't accept it. But when Islam came in, they said, he's Hafiz Quran, he loves Allah, he loves Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He has the right to be our leader. We'll follow. So this is what Islam is all about. So Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is telling us, this what happens, so let's run after them, chase them. They are leaving, let's chase them, because they are full of fear now. So let's chase them. Halfway through, those people ran faster away when they hear that Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam chasing them with the best fighters. So they gone. So here's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that they said, Alhamdulillah to Allah that He saved us the battle. And not, we did not get hurt. So even when they all get saved, they thank Allah for it. They thank Allah for support, they thank Allah for this, they thank Allah for that. And also they said, Alhamdulillah that we are safe, we did not get hurt. لَمْ يُصَبْنَا السُّوءُ لَمْ يُمْسَسْنَا السُّوءُ سُوءُ means nothing hurt, we are not hurt anymore. So they are thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the final thing, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is telling us, there is a situation called Uyayna, Bitru Uyayna. A group of people, they made a trick on the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam again, and they killed the people who are in charge of serving them and helping them, and they stole the camels that belongs to Baitul Man and so on. It's called Bir'unayn. And also, they killed the Muslim women. So Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam sent the campaign after them, and, you know, have a big fight, and they have a good revenge. And also the Ghatafan tribe, the largest tribe in Arabia, it's called Ghatafan, which they are against Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. They pulled themselves out from the coalition of Quraysh. They said, Ya Rasulullah, okay, we're not going to fight you anymore, we're not going to support them anymore. Leave us alone. It's okay. Left them alone. And again, the final thing, there are also in between, there was some kind of captives in those campaigns. The Muslim brought in captives, like prisoners, from different campaigns. Now Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he started calling that, pay ransom, you get them back to their tribes and families. So point is, the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did not leave the Muslims without telling them, pumping them, motivate them. We have to establish our state of Islam, because if we keep fighting, we wait for them to fight. No, we should teach them a good lesson so nobody would dare to fight us again. For one reason, to have peace. Because if you're not fighting, there is peace. And if there is peace, the da'wah of Islam will be spread faster.
You remember that?
So Allah will give Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam the energy to dedicate the time to spreading Islam. He start sending messages to the leaders of the Ummah around because of that little tiny time of peace. So here what happens, Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after this campaign, the result now, listen to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent in Surah Al-Ahzab again, the same surah. Because Allah described the whole campaign of Ahzab in one surah. But this ayah is number 25. This is the summary that Allah wants us to know. He said, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَرَدَّ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بِغَيْظِهِمْ لَمْ يَنَالُوا خَيْرًا وَكَفَى اللَّهُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ الْقِتَالِ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ قَوِيًّا عَزِيزًا. Allah said, the believers, they said, Allah turned away the kafir from us. And also, they did not get whatever they came for. لَمْ يَنَالُوا خَيْرًا لَمْ يَنَالُوا خَيْرًا. That means they came to destroy us, which is khayr for them, shar for us, but they did not get it. And also he said, Allah saved the mu'mineen from fighting. وَكَفَى اللَّهُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ الْقِتَالِ. That means Allah saved the believers from fighting, because fighting is awful thing, you know. It's very massive hurt, you know, will help. And again says, وَكَانَ اللَّهُ قَوِيًّا عَزِيزًا. And Allah establishing to us, I am the قَوِيُّ الْجَبَّارُ الْعَزِيزُ. I will not abandon my believers. I will never allow kafir to be ruling or killing the believers, if they are believers. This is the condition. Because some of you will ask, how about now? What happens? He's abandoning us now. You know why? Because Allah said, Al-mu'mineen al-kafir Allah al-mu'mineen al-kitan. Mu'min, when you are mu'min, we are Muslims. Yes, but are we mu'min yet? And this is the level we're looking for. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكَفَى اللَّهُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ الْقِتَالِ. Allah will protect mu'mins. And Allah will never allow kafir to have on top of the mu'mineen the upper hand. Is it now the same picture? No, it's not, because are we Zain, are we believers, good believers? What kind of percentage of believing we are in? That's why we have to look around. What makes us fit the description of believers? You go and read surah called Al-Mu'minun. Again, the surah is called Al-Mu'minun, believers. What is the first ayah? قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, definitely, surely, the mu'minun was successful. Aflaha al-mu'min. Who are those? You read the description of those believers after 11 ayah from that one. You keep doing. Aflaha al-mu'minun, al-ladhina, so-and-so, al-ladhina, so-and-so, al-ladhina, so-and-so, wa, so-and-so. Allah spread around all the description. If you are a believer, you follow those ones and be one of them. Be one of those ones. And that's when the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is always teaching us to be mu'min. He said, to be a Muslim, everybody can be a Muslim by saying, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, and I pray, and I make zakah, and fast Ramadan, and make hajj whenever I can. But how much of Allah you believe in? The mu'min is when you believe in Allah, His messenger, His malaika, angels, His messengers, His books, and the Day of Judgment, and the fate of Qada or Qadr, bad and good. If you fit that description, you are a believer. And then the description after that in the Surah Aflah al-Mu'minun, Surah al-Mu'minun. Read it, please. This is your homework, sir. You got your candy. Your homework. Read after Surah al-Mu'minun. And most for all of you, you're laughing at because I pick on this guy. You know, he's one of those days. So it's a homework for all of you. Read that surah and benefit from it. Because I really advise all of us to read Surah Al-Mu'minun and read translation and tafsir and see what it means to you. At the end, the answer will come to you. The homework from last week, the one I told you, how much you know about Allah loving you, how much you think Allah loves you. You prove to me the reasons why Allah loves you. When you read that surah, you fit yourself in the picture. Which one of them is, I'm not here, I'm not here, I'm not here, I'm not here. Watch out, don't count yourself away from God. If you are out, make sure you are in back again. At least it will give you the guideline how to be a mu'min. And if you are a mu'min, you are under the protection of who? George Bush? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'll tell you what, everybody says Allah, so everybody will tell what can be, right? Started from the right or left side? Left? Left. Okay, there is one, two, three, four, five. Okay, there we go. Oops. One more? Last one? Oops. Okay, one for you. Because really, you are very, very beautiful people today. I enjoy your company. I laughed a lot. Are you laughing again? I'm going to give it to you. Don't give it to anybody. I don't care. I love giving. I love. And if you practice giving, believe me, the feeling of giving is so beautiful. The feeling of giving, if you have that feeling, honestly, you don't feel happy you've taken. You always like to give. It's the sensation is so beautiful. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us everything, because He loves giving. He gives you everything before you ask. He gave you that face, that eyes, that mother and father you have the family. He gave you, did you ask for them? Did you ask for your mom and dad? Did you ask for your brothers and sisters? Did you ask about your nation? Did you ask about Islam? Did you ask Allah to give you this and give you that? No. He loves you so much because He loves to give. So He gave you all of this. How about if you try to be like Him a little bit? Try to give. The feeling of giving is so beautiful. Seriously. I hope and I pray to Allah that each one of you will have the taste of giving. How it's beautiful. And the idea is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us to be His Khalifa on earth, to represent Him on earth. Do you think to be a miser and cheap representing Allah? Are we? Because if you think you're not going to give, remember Hadith of Rasulullah. One time he looked at Aisha radiallahu anha. Aisha was counting the money she's going to give. Okay, I want to give this and give this. Okay, I'll keep those ones and give. He said, Ya Aisha, La tuhsi ala Allahi fa yuhsi alayki. Don't count what you're going to give to Allah, because Allah might start counting on you. So she said, okay, I'm giving this. So she understood what he meant. She gave everything she had. So the whole idea is, don't count on Allah. Don't count what you give. Al-Abbas and his son, Abdullah ibn Abbas, when they used to give, they used to look at this and close their eyes and give. They didn't want to count. Because what they heard the Rasulullah, if you start counting what you're going to give back to Allah, what Allah's going to do? You counted on me, you don't want to give everything you have? Okay, I'm going to start counting. I'm not going to give you this and I'm going to... You start counting. So the idea is, the hadith itself, with Aisha radiallahu anha, represent the attitude of believers towards Allah. And what your attitude towards Allah match you, the same. If your attitude to not to love Allah, what do you expect from Allah to do? If you said, I'm not going to love Allah. So the idea is, do something like the quality of Allah. Allah says, I'm going to create you to be my representative on earth. Khalifatan. When he's talking about Khalifa, which means somebody who represent or come to be in charge after the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What Allah wants you to do? To spread the haq, the word of Allah, and to act like that. To do things, to be merciful to each other, to forgive each other, to give each other, to help each other. Because Allah, Al-Ma'in, you remember Allah Al-Ma'in, that means He's the one who help, the one who support. How come you don't help me when I ask for help, sir? You don't like my face, I know. But the idea is, Muslims are the ones supposed to be a role model on earth, to be sabbaq. Sabbaq means to be number one to jump to help. Now look at us. When a disaster happens in my country or yours, who are the first one to jump to help? Muslims? The kafir, the salim, they come in. Am I right? So, let's try at least individually, let's try to give the attitude. Maybe collectively Allah will look at us and say, look how many of them they are doing it, I'm going to help them out to revive the ummah. And it only needs one group to represent this ummah right. Allah will never destroy a nation with one person righteous. Imagine if a group of us would be righteous the way Allah wants us to be. That means the mercy of the whole ummah will be because of those people. Allah protect the whole ummah for one person who worship Him right. When the malaika used to say, Allah, let us destroy this ummah, there is no except one. They know because of one saved the rest. So, it's time for us to think very hard how to be mu'min. And say, Allah, help me out. What do you say? But you guys, you do it 17 times a day minimum. Iyaka na'budu an? What does it mean? We worship you and we ask you for help. Okay, so the idea is, we are saying it in the Fard Salah every day 17 times. Iyaka na'budu, we worship you, and Iyaka nasta'een. Why don't you ask him again, Ya Allah, help me out. I'd like to be a mu'min. And believe me, Allah promised, whoever wants to come close to Allah, Allah will come close. If you came walking, Allah will come running towards you. And would you imagine Allah coming running for you, or to you, or toward you? Because He knows your heart is true. If you are faking it, Allah will come. No. But please, be sincere with Allah. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open our heart to do that. Let's pray for Adam, and we'll finalize everything inshallah after that.